Good morning, dear students. I am Dr. Sakshi Verma, Assistant Professor in Zoology, Hansraj Mehla Mahavidyalaya. Today, we are going to discuss about the life history and development of starfish. This topic is for the students of B.Sc Medical Semester 2. As we all know, starfish is a unisexual organism, that is, the male and female reproductive organs are present in separate individuals. But there is no any sexual dimorphism. The gonads are present in pairs, one pair in the base of each arm lying freely between pyloric ceca and ampulla of duophyte. Gametes are released from gonads through minute opening called as gonopore, situated laterally on the aboral surface. Since the gametes are released free in the seawater, which is the habitat of starfish, the fertilization occurs in the seawater only. Therefore, this kind of fertilization is called as external fertilization. In this case, the sperm, it fuses with the ovum, and only the nucleus and cytoplasm of sperm, they enter into the ovum while flagella is left outside. And this results into the formation of a zygote. This zygote, after formation, develops a membrane called as fertilization membrane around it. This membrane will prevent the entry of another sperm within the ovum. Therefore, this membrane protects, or it acts as a barrier for polyspermy. Polyspermy is the fusion of the ovum with more than one sperm. So in this case, only one sperm can fertilize the ovum. After the formation of the zygote, cleavage starts, and by the second day, the blastula is formed. Blastula is a single layered or one layered ciliated embryo, as you can see in this section. This blastula has internal a cavity called as blastocoele, and it is filled with blastocoelic fluid. Now this blastula then undergoes gastrulation. How the gastrula is formed? It first of all undergoes invagination. Now you can see here, in this case, this layer will move inside, as this is the early gastrula. Here, one layer, the single layer, which is around the blastocoele, at one point it will start invaginating and thus results into the formation of another cavity. This cavity is called as archenteron, and this area, the opening from which the cavity it is able to communicate to the outside, this opening is called as blastopore. Now this early gastrula, it becomes cup shaped structure and double layered. The outer layer is called as the ectoderm, while as the inner layer is called as endoderm. From the advancing end of archenteron, few cells, they buds off from the archenteron, and they will form the mesoderm, or they are the mesenchyme cells and they will form the mesoderm. Also, further, the advancing end of archenteron, it forms or buds off coelomic pouches, left and right coelomic pouches, which will form the coelom, mesodermal lining, and the water vascular system. So until now, the gastrula is being formed. This is a free swimming larva stage, but the larvae formation starts after this. So until now, we have seen the embryogeny of the starfish. After the formation of gastrula, the larva formation occurs. There are three larval stages in case of starfish, Number 1, Diplurula larva. Number 2 is Bipinaria larva. And number 3 is Brachiolaria larva. First of all, let us see the Diplurula larva, or it is also called as early Bipinaria larva. It is the first larval stage, and this larva, since it resembles the hypothetical Diplurula larva, it has been believed that all modern echinoderms have been derived from a Diplurula-like ancestor. This early Bipinaria is egg-shaped structure. Now, it is very different from the previous structure, that is Gastrula. Now, the mouth, the digestive system has been formed. Now, how does it is formed? Let us see. What happens? From the anterior side of this early Bipinaria, the mouth is formed by the midventral ectodermal invagination called stomodium, and this becomes continuous with the underlying archenteron. The anterior region forms the larval mouth, while as the blastopore structure, which was present in the gastrula, it gives rise to the formation of anus, and archenteron, the cavity of the gastrula, it will differentiate into a digestive tract having esophagus, stomach and intestine. Also, the uniform ciliation of gastrula, since we saw that the gastrula as well as blastula was uniformly ciliated, in this case it is replaced by two ciliary bands. One band is perioral band, you can see here. This is the perioral band of cilia which surrounds the mouth, and another one is adoral band which lies inside the mouth. Therefore, it is not being shown here since it lies within the mouth. Now, this larva is actively feeding larva. It feeds upon the food particles such as unicellular algae, particularly diatoms, and these are collected from the water current produced by the adoral cilia present inside the mouth. Now, this larva swims forward with the help of the perioral band. The perioral band, which is present around the mouth, it rotates clockwise and thus leads to the forward movement of the early Bipinaria larva. The second larva is Bipinaria larva. This Diplurula larva, it soon forms on its front side a large preoral lobe. This is the preoral lobe, and this lobe is surrounded by or bordered by the preoral loop of cilia. So, the perioral band of cilia, which was present in early Bipinaria, now it forms the preoral loop, one loop, the preoral loop. Another loop is also formed, that is called as postoral loop. This is the postoral loop, as you can see the darker area in this diagram. This shows the postoral loop. This postoral loop, it surrounds the lateral lobes. As you can see here, this is the lateral lobe. There are three lateral lobes. Only two can be visible here because it is a two-dimensional diagram. So, the lateral lobes are surrounded by postoral loop, and the preoral lobe is bordered by the preoral loop of cilia. Now, this larva is called as Bipinaria larva. It again has the mouth, esophagus, stomach, intestine and anus. This larva is bilaterally symmetrical larva. It swims and feeds freely, and after some weeks, it transforms into the next larval stage, that is the Brachiolaria larva. Now, the lobes of the Bipinaria, the lobes which were present in the Bipinaria larva, as you can see in this diagram, now this will form the slender ciliated contractile structures called larval arms. For example, you can see here the preoral lobe, it give rise to the formation of non-ciliated appendages. Now the cilia has been removed and these are the non-ciliated appendages, and these are called as fixing processes, or these are the arms, larval arms, and these have suckers or adhesive disc at their ends. These appendages are also called as brachiolarian arms or fixing processes. Now the larva, it is again bilaterally symmetrical and it can swim and feed actively. This larva will gradually metamorphose into a small sea star. It means this larval structure will show drastic change internally as well as externally to form the sea star. The next topic is metamorphosis, that is how this structure it give rise to the formation of sea star. In about 6 to 7 weeks of time, the brachiolaria settles on some solid object with the help of its fixing processes and suckers. It attaches to any solid surface using its suckers or adhesive discs, and the preoral lobe here, it will form a stalk for adhesion. This stalk is later degenerated and becomes completely absorbed. Therefore, the adult structure is formed from the posterior rounded structure. So this structure will be degenerated as it forms the stalk and it is degenerated, and thus the adult or the small sea star is being separated or detached from the stalk. During this process, the larval mouth, the larval anus, they disappear, and new mouths and anus are formed. 5 rudiment arms, they appear around the oral and aboral surface or axis. So formed skeletal elements also appear on the arm rudiments, and radial canals grow into them. General body cavity or coelom of adult develops from right and left larval coelomic sacs. In each arm, 2 pairs of outgrowths form the first 2 feet, which serve for attachment, and further complex reorganizational changes results into the formation of adult sea star. This sea star, which detaches itself from the stalk, is very small in size. It is around 1 mm with short stubby arms. Later on, this sea star grows and attains the adult size and start reproducing. So this was all about how the sea star, it shows external fertilization, and how after fertilization the embryo develops into gastrula, and the gastrula it later goes through larval stages and it forms the adult structure.